Thank you, and thank you for having me back once again at KURJA POLT, and for having me back in your wonderful city. It's so wonderful to be here. And I know it's for the first time. I've presented a number of times at KURJA POLT, and I think this is the first time I'm presenting where I haven't got a cold in the first couple of days of being here. So Alexia had that instead this year. So it's swings and roundabouts. Today I'm going to be talking about, as you can see from the slide, subtraction and compression in contemporary indie horror. I suppose the first thing I want to clarify is that I'm only going to be talking about a couple of examples of indie horror here. I'm going to be talking about American examples specifically. And when I say indie horror, I'm referring to a type of independent horror that's attempting to be commercial and align itself with a genre, not the kind of the other kinds of indie horror might, for instance, align themselves with artistic expression or experimentation in the sort of the realms of experimental film. That's not what I'm going to be talking about here when I'm referring to indie horror. I want to begin with a statement that might on the face of it sound controversial, though I don't think it should be, and that's that genre films are by definition generic. And I think the reason why that might sound controversial on the face of it is because it might sound like an insult, because this association between being generic and belonging to a genre have broadly, in critical circles, been perceived as a way of insulting a certain type of film. And I'll come to why in a moment. What I mean by this is that simply that in order to align themselves with a genre, filmmakers might take on a set of repeated ideas, conventions, tropes, aesthetics, stylistics, or character archetypes that clearly align what they're producing, the type of story they're trying to tell, with a certain set of generic expectations. And those expectations are incredibly useful in various ways. They're especially useful for audiences who have a broad understanding of which films belong to which genres and can use genres as a way of deciding which films that they want to engage with, and also to decode a film appropriately. So because of the generic context, for instance, we know whether it's okay, whether we laugh when someone's decapitated, for instance, because in certain genres it would be completely inappropriate for us to perceive that as a moment of humour. In others, it would be perfectly acceptable. On the flip side of this, genres are also incredibly useful to filmmakers because, as Grindon notes here, genres allow filmmakers, or these elements of genre, conventions, tropes, ideas, and aesthetics, allow filmmakers to build narratives around patterns that have satisfied audiences in the past. So they can produce films that they know are going to produce the right kinds of enjoyment in audiences, and I don't see anything wrong with that in the slightest. What this does mean, however, is that if you make your film generic, the closer you align your film with these conventions, tropes, ideas, and aesthetics, and character types, and so forth, then the safer your investment becomes as a filmmaker in terms of finding an audience who are likely to be satisfied by that film. However, there is this idea that being generic is, for some reason, a bad thing. This is not something I agree with, but this is one way of expressing that, and I'll unpick some implications of this quotation in a moment. Bolcina puts it that a horror film, and I'm going to be focusing on horror film as my core genre here, horror film producers and directors, because they align themselves with genres, do not need to search for new ideas because scary movies seem to be lucrative and prolific nonetheless. And for critics, the lack of fabular originality is presented as the biggest problem with these kinds of films. Now, there, as I say, there are a number of implications I want to unpick that are buried within this critical way of thinking, even if not they're not directly present in this particular quote from Fortuna. The first is that audiences for genre films are undiscerning, like that they go to these films simply to receive a type of pleasure that comes out of knowing what we're going to get and having that need fulfilled, that these repeated ideas and tropes signal the sort of homogeneity of genre films, signals somehow that audiences have no taste and should know better. And in this case, the implication is that critics do know better and audiences don't know what's good for them. If they did, they wouldn't seek these kinds of films. The second implication is that genre films are profitable. That's something that comes out of Balchina's quotation. Now, again, I don't necessarily see what the problem is with this, because anyone who thinks that seeking to make a commercial film means making a film that isn't going to make any money doesn't seem to understand what commercial filmmaking is. Because in order to make more films afterwards, you might hope that your film makes some money so that you've got more money to make more films. Nevertheless, there's a connotation, especially that surrounds genre films, that producers of these kinds of films are somehow greedy or money-grubbing or just out to exploit audience weakness, because audiences don't know better for themselves, according to this logic, and that there's no artistry involved in this kind of filmmaking. Again, this is nothing that I agree with. I'm just laying out the critical position. I think this is especially true when it comes to studio horror filmmaking, and I think that's simply because the more money that gets involved, the more likely these films are to be perceived as being aligned with that sort of money-grubbing sensibility of just being a commercial enterprise. I think there's other ways that these associations between studio filmmaking and money and being greedy will become apparent as we move forward, as I start talking about indie film. But for the moment, I'd like to put a pin in the idea that the critical connotations that surround genre film seem to posit that being generic or aligning oneself with a genre means being uncreative, and it's almost like being generic is the enemy of creativity. Now, the second broad state that I want to posit here is that independent horror filmmakers sometimes I'd try to align themselves with these same kinds of ways of approaching genre, but in doing so, they face significant challenges because it's difficult for an independent horror filmmaker that doesn't have a great deal of money to compete with the major studio system in terms of the glossiness of the production, but also more importantly in terms of the marketing budgets that are associated with studio filmmaking that would allow an independent filmmaker the same access to the market that a studio might enjoy. Where I become interested in this is where I engage with independent horror film a lot, and when I see independent horror film, I tend to see many more original ideas coming out of that area. I think there's two reasons for that. One is that there's fewer executives worried about the branding of their studio, and there's probably fewer heavy investors who have invested a hell of a lot of money in the production breathing down the creative personnel's necks. But also I think that the market situation itself lends itself to putting a different set of pressures on independent horror filmmakers to stand out in a crowded marketplace by offering original ideas and playing with convention rather than trying to compete on the same grounds as mainstream studio horror filmmakers. Now, for the moment, that's where I want to leave independent film. I'll come back to some examples to illustrate all of this in a moment. But I want to move forward by thinking about the idea of innovation itself and how, as Russ has already alluded to, innovation becomes associated with the idea of adding elements in rather than subtracting them, which is going to be the focus of my talk. Here's an example of one way that addition manifests, when it comes to the horror film at least. If horror films are associated with the idea of being generic and repetitive, that's never more true than with the horror film sequel. There's a lot of horror film sequels, and sequels themselves are largely perceived as being repetitive because they tend to replicate the same, not only situations and scenarios, but also the same characters and the same character motivations. So the worst of all worlds in this sort of critical this critical sense is the horror film sequel. And here are two examples of late sequels to long-running franchises. Jason X is the 10th film in the Friday the 13th series, and Leprechaun in Space is the 4th film in the long-running Leprechaun series. Both of these are examples of situations where we've got the same sort of ideas playing out a number of times, and in order to refresh the idea, in order to keep the audience's attention, something else is added in. The central action of the film is relocated in both circumstances, in this cliched way, they became a cliche because of films like this, into space. We need to take the kind of ideas we already have, transplant them to space. But in doing so, and this is where it becomes interesting for me, it brings along with it a new set of genre conventions here from sci-fi that are just bolted on top of the original action. So in order to refresh, we add something in. That idea of addition being associated with innovation is also present in the scholarly literature surrounding the idea of innovation. Here are just five examples of books that have been published recently on innovation. Some are edited collections, some are about innovation within culture specifically. And what's notable about these books, and believe me, I've done the searching for through these books, is that none of them use terms that are associated with subtraction when they're talking about innovation. I'm talking about words like delete, refine, strip down, strip back, subtract, edit, delete. Those words are never associated with innovation because innovation itself as an idea is so deeply synonymous with the idea of adding. In the examples I'm going to be looking at, I'm going to be instead focusing on how subtraction can be used as a form of innovation, which itself, I suppose, is innovative. But I'm going to begin with an example to illustrate what I mean, which is I didn't come here to die. I'm going to be using two examples today. Both of them begin with very generic setups. I Didn't Come Here to Die is a horror film that is based around a summer camp featuring teenagers who arrive to build a camp for underprivileged youths. Now, this generic setup draws on a long-standing tradition within the horror genre that is exemplified by films such as Friday the 13th or The Burning or Mad Men and so forth. They're all set around summer camps. Now, we can understand that we are supposed to decode I Didn't Come Here to Die in relation to these earlier examples, because we're told so in the opening sequence, which begins like this, hopefully.
I'm a police officer, I'm here to help you. Fuck this.
So I Didn't Come Here to Die begins with this sheriff being chased through the woods by what seems to be a ghostly figure with a bloodied face and no eyes. And we can tell we're supposed to relate this to an earlier period of horror filmmaking because of this title card, which is one of the only places in the film we get this sort of grindhouse aesthetic with this sort of run-down look, which is evocative of films from the 1970s or early 1980s. As the film progresses forward, it anchors this meaning for us, even though at this stage we've got no context for this particular sequence. We then move into the film properly, where we see the teenagers who go to build the summer camp. When the teenagers arrive to build their summer camp, this is one of the first ways they talk about the area that they're located in.
Oh, but why way out here?
This land was donated to volunteers in America, generating goodwill by a family of a young girl who was murdered last year.
Murdered? Well, maybe she roams these very woods seeking revenge, like a decrepit, rotting zombie lusting for brains. Pretty good idea for a horror movie, if you ask me.
So we're already beginning to make the connections between the images that we saw in the opening credits and what might happen within the film, based on these sort of generic expectations that we see teenagers going out into the woods, and we've already got the setup of what looked maybe like the ghost of a girl who might roam the woods and attack people, but also because of the way the generic conventions have been set up prior to us necessarily engaging with I Didn't Come Here to Die. This tradition of having teenagers sat around a campfire talking about what happened previously in the same area is something we see repeated in all of these previous summer camp horror films. Here's one example from Friday the 13th Part 2.
Legend has it that Jason saw his mother beheaded that night, that he took his revenge. A revenge that he'll continue to seek if anyone ever enters his wilderness again.
Now, I find these sequences really interesting, but not because they set up what is likely to happen in the future of the plot based on what happened previously in the area. It's like a kind of reverse prophecy, which is, that's the part where I become interested, because I'm interested in time. But nevertheless, we can see that we're expecting now to see these teenagers being picked off one by one by this ghostly entity because of the generic setup and how the generic expectations that we've been built up before we enter into interaction with this film. However, that isn't what happens in I Didn't Come Here to Die. In fact, there is no ghostly malevolent entity in I Didn't Come Here to Die. We didn't get any context for it originally. Eventually, we find out what happened in the opening sequence because it's a flash forwards to the very end of the story. Just after they hear the campfire tale in I Didn't Come Here to Die, we get a first sense of what this film's modus operandi is. And that's when this happens.
Fucking morons! All of you! I know way deep down inside that I have a great ass, and I'm gonna go tell Sophia that you guys...
So in case you can't see it because it's quite dark, one of the camp counselors turns around very sharply and impales her eye on a branch. And this is the film's modus operandi. We remove the malevolent entity from the equation, which seems absurd because that should be the source of horror in this kind of film. And because we've removed that, the teenagers still go out into the woods and die one by one, but they do so through their own incompetence or because they kill each other. They come to fill the generic void that's been left by removing this seemingly essential ingredient. As it turns out, and we only find out this in the very final shot of the film where Miranda, she's taken to hospital, then she returns in a white gown and does exactly the same thing in the final shot of the film, turns around too sharply and loses her other eye. So the entity we see at the beginning is actually this camp counsellor who's wandering around, not screaming, trying to attack the sheriff, but screaming around in confusion and pain because she's just lost her second eye, or her penultimate eye, as I like to call it, because I find the phrase quite amusing. As the film moves forward, I've just written a chapter about this for a book, and I had to restrain myself for not referring to it as a penultimate eye. Every time I read it, I was like, I'm going to change that, but I didn't. I chickened out. As the film moves forward, we get this sort of chain of events that are oriented around these kind of ludicrous accidents and ludicrous incompetence. Here's another example where one of the camp counsellors, Julie, suffers her fate.
Headgear.
No, it hurts too much. My friggin' goggles.
Okay, it's your face.
Importantly, Julie doesn't die at this point in the film, and I'll return to why that's important later. As it turns out, because Julie's now suffering, Steve, who's there in the scene with her, eventually notices and tries to save her, but he can't dislodge the chainsaw from her face, so he revs it up slightly, splitting her head in two. He then, feeling so terrible about what he's done, hangs himself. Beyond that, one of the other camp counsellors, Chris, reveals that he's only part of the volunteer corps because he's on court-mandated community service. And he thinks the situation looks so ridiculous, everyone will assume he murdered Julie. So he tries to bury Julie's body. He's caught doing so by the camp leader. He panics because she thinks he's murdered Julie. And so he stabs her, and so it goes on until everyone's dead. So we remove the seemingly core ingredient. The teens still die one by one as the narrative progresses in this very conventional way, but in this slightly unexpected way. More than just being amusing or slightly surprising, I think what this film does is much smarter and more interesting. And that becomes more evident when we start to see a different kind of conventional expectation that's set around these films, which is based around the expectations of critics. Here are three examples of how this kind of film, just sort of generic sort of camp-based horror film, are responded to by critics typically. Kim Newman puts it that the victims in these films are invariably a parade of dumb American kids who are marked for death, and all the characters act like idiots and so deserve the consequences that befall them. Whitehead agrees, suggesting that teens never learn in these films and are too stupid to live. And Murr puts it that the teens are so unlikable that you don't empathise with them, don't I? Thanks for that. Meaning that we're supposed to think that they deserve to die. These critics themselves, if anyone in this equation are idiots, because what they're doing is confusing their perspective as critics who have seen a number of these films and so have a set of generic expectations with the perspective of the characters. Of course, the teens don't learn from the mistakes of other teens in other situations because they haven't experienced them themselves. The teens in these films, from their perspective, are living their daily lives and have no reason to expect that these kind of violent incidents will befall them. What these critics do is treat these films really unfairly because they've come to them with the presumption that these kinds of horror films just repeat the same ideas and are generic and therefore are bad. What I Didn't Come Here to Die does is critiques these critics, but it does so in a really interesting way. Rather than, it would be really easy to gainsay what these critics do by making the teens really clever, really savvy, really empathetic and really nice, but that isn't what this film does. Instead, it gives us a surprisingly selfish cohort of protagonists. So when they first arrive at the camp, the teens are reminded, and we are reminded, that the purpose of joining this kind of volunteer corps is to help other people. Moments later, they're asked why they joined up as volunteers, and they all give surprisingly self-oriented answers. For instance, Steve, who you saw in the previous scene, who hangs himself, says that he's there because he thought it'd be a good way to meet people. Miranda, who gets the branch in the eye, says she wants it for a CV so she can go onto a different leadership position. Julie, who takes the chainsaw to the face, thinks that it's probably going to be better than staying at home for another summer, I guess. None of them are really interested in helping other people. So we might say they lean into the generic stereotype that these are obnoxious kids who deserve to die. But as the title goes, they didn't come here to die. What this film does is instead builds these characters as flawed human beings, but fundamentally realistic and motivated ones. That's how it begins to flesh them out. And I'm going to take Julie as a case in point. Julie joins the volunteer corps because she guesses it will be better than staying at home for another summer. When she arrives as a volunteer, however, all she does is complain about the work she has to do, because her character type is someone who speaks immediate gratification and doesn't think about the consequences of the future. So she joins the volunteer corps not thinking that it will involve a lot of work, so she complains while she's there. On the first night in the camp, this is what she says to her colleague, Chris.
Please tell me you plan on busting out that booze tonight.
Are you kidding? We've got the work tomorrow.
And?
So she recognizes that she's reminded that there might be a consequence of her actions, but she wants the pleasure now. And this is the reason why, because she's been drinking, she has a hangover the next day. That's why she doesn't wear her headgear, because her head hurts too much. And while she's seeking immediate gratification of not wanting to do the work that's involved in being a volunteer, messing around with a chainsaw, that's when her fate befalls her. However, I don't think we're led to think that she deserves her fate simply because she's obnoxious. And I think we're led to believe that simply because her death, the fact that she deserves to die, is separated out from her obnoxiousness. She doesn't die when this happens to her. She only dies when Steve tries to intervene. Notably, Steve thinks that Julie's obnoxious. He expresses so moments before she dies, but even he doesn't think she deserves this fate. He tries to help her, and in fact, he feels so bad about failing to help her that he takes his own life. That separation out between the death and the deserving, in this case, I think is really important as a way of addressing the flawed critical reception of these kind of films. But it also helps us to see that what this film in particular is doing once it's subtracted out that malevolent entity. It leaves us with a set of characters that look like stock types and then fleshes out those types so that we understand them from their perspective as human beings. Julie dies because she's a flawed human being and her flaws lead her towards her death. But it's not like it's just she stumbles into the woods, she's stupid and she doesn't learn, and therefore she's a sucker for this malevolent entity. What I Didn't Come Here to Die does by subtracting is offering us surprises that I would argue cause us to reflect on the subgenre or the genre in a slightly different way when we engage with it in the future. The second example I want to consider uses a different kind of subtractive technique, and that's to use compression as a form of subtraction. And that might sound weird to start off with until we think about how the filmic medium itself naturalizes the idea of compression as a form of subtraction via editing. All editing is essentially compressing time by removing large chunks of it. As Hitchcock famously put it, and I'm paraphrasing badly here, I'm sure, because I don't have the actual quote in front of me. A film is like life with all the boring bits cut out, and that's how editing works. Radical compression of time by removing large chunks of it. That way of compressing time, that sort of subtractive technique, is so naturalized that we might fail to even notice it, simply because we've seen so many films that we're so used to how editing works, and because the editing techniques themselves are so powerful, but also because it's just become part of how we expect to engage with film. It is itself a convention that we might fail to notice. One of the ways I entered into thinking about editing in this respect, that in the way that we're going to investigate with my second case study, is by the work of James Cutting. And James Cutting's particularly interested in how we don't notice editing and the powers of editing because we don't notice it. Cutting argues that when we think about the narrative structure of film, we tend to think, because of how screenplay guides work and so forth, of films being divided into different acts of establishing a situation, raising complications or conflict, and then resolving the conflict, for instance. What Cutting does is takes a number of different popular films and takes those different acts, say the conflict section of a film, and across a different range of films, and looks for different norms of pacing within those acts. And he finds patterns in how peaks of excitement are paced within different films and how we get micro lulls within each act. And he finds that those hold true for a wide range of popular films, meaning that the way those films are not only structured but edited shape our expectations as audience members, even if we're not aware of it. And wherever we have norms that are setting up our expectations, we have the potential for filmmakers to play with those norms in order to offer us surprises. And this is where we come to my second example, which is called Murder Loves Killers 2, and note that it's T-O-O, not T-W-O. This isn't a sequel. Again, this film begins with a very generic situation. Five teens go out into a woodland cabin in a rural location for vacation. This is the kind of thing we might see in, for instance, films like Texas Chainsaw Massacre and so forth, that we might be quite used to seeing, or The Evil Dead is another good example of this. What usually happens in these kind of films is we have a cast of protagonists and they are killed one by one as the film progresses, but the pacing becomes really important because the kills are usually spread out across the first three acts of the film so that we have peaks of excitement so that it maintains our interest. What that means is that the majority of the structure of those films is largely taken up with teenagers doing quite mundane teenage things, possibly as a way of, we could take that as a counter to some of the critical responses around these films, because these teenagers are just living their daily lives. They shouldn't expect violence to befall them. So they might do things like smoking weed or dancing, and believe me, Crispin Glover is dancing here. He's not being electrocuted, even though it might look like it. Or having sex, or even, in my favourite example, from Friday the 13th, part 5, all of these are from Friday the 13th series, going to the toilet. We'll just see why this becomes relevant shortly, but we get the majority of the film following teenagers around doing teenage things, and then the violence intersects, and the violence is surprising and exciting because of these lulls where we just get normal, mundane activity. Murder Loves Killers 2 does something very different, and this becomes evident in the very first interior shot of the cabin when they first arrive at their vacation home, when this happens.
Run.
You know what? Go ahead. I think I'm going to.
Okay, you know.
I'm going to.
You should just go.
Okay.
Are you worried about your figure?
No. I can eat whatever I like and I don't gain a pound.
Ooh, a lower body.
Wait, what'd you say, honey?
So they're at the cabin for less than 3 minutes in the first unbroken shot of the interior of the cabin, and one of them, Lindy, is abducted. 2 minutes later, her boyfriend Kyle is also abducted. By the 30-minute mark, all of the protagonists, apart from the lead protagonist, Aggie, are dead. And that's an incredibly unusual way of structuring this kind of film. And what we essentially get is the compression of what would usually be the first three acts of a slasher film down into the first 30 minutes. We can tell that the film's being compressed as well, because while Lindy and her boyfriend Kyle are off being murdered, the remaining teens have a there's a 3-minute sequence where they enjoy an entire day of drinking and partying. And the compression within that sequence is flagged for us by the film's stylistics. Because, for instance, when one of the teens has too much to drink and slumps down, this happens. Now, the jump cut is not a particularly surprising technique in film, but it is quite unusual in this kind of generic filmmaking. It's not something we usually see. In this case, this teenager slumped down, having too much to drink, and her friends, as a joke, have removed her clothes, and it's nowhere near as creepy as that sounds when it's in the context of the film. She takes in good spirits as the kind of prank they play on each other, for instance. The thing that I find interesting about this is that it's signalling to us how compressed that afternoon of drinking and partying is at this point. And it does so to set up what it does beyond the 30-minute mark where all the teens are dead. Because at that point, the pace suddenly slows to an absolute crawl. This is from a sequence just after Tamara, the teenager you've just seen, is dead. She's the last surviving protagonist, apart from the lead protagonist, Aggie, who's here. This sequence is one in which the killer, Stevie, who you see in the background there, looks around the room trying to find where Aggie is because he knows she's still in the house at this stage. So he just looks at different potential hiding places and Aggie has to move around the room away from him to try and remain hidden. This sequence lasts 10% of the film's runtime and is part of a broader sequence of the film that lasts a quarter of the film's runtime where it has no dialogue at all, which really makes this kind of film, which is very unusual for that amount of silence to happen, feel incredibly slow. Another of the sequences that happens during this broader sequence is this, where Aggie finds herself in a room where she's behind a locked door and she uses a wire hanger to try and hook a key from underneath the door so she can unlock it. This sequence goes on for 3 minutes, which is absolutely excruciating. It doesn't sound very long until you're watching it. And it feels all the slower because previously we had a 3-minute sequence where an entire day of drinking and partying was compressed into exactly the same length of time as we're seeing here, which makes it just feels so desperately slow. The odd thing that this film does then is compresses all this, the usual structure of a slasher film down into 30 minutes and then leaves us in this uncharted slow territory where we have no map for what's going to happen anymore because our generic expectations are usually we get 15 minutes of a confrontation between the lead protagonist and the killer in this case. Instead, we get this empty space where anything could happen and we get these slow moments where we're led to think that we don't really know what's going to happen next. There's something else that odd that happens in this very sequence that I want to draw our attention to, and that's it, when the protagonist Aggie, still locked in the room, looks through a keyhole and sees the killer Stevie. I want to point out a couple of things about this sequence after you've seen it. And the first thing I want to point out about that sequence is that in this kind of film, as I've already pointed out, the majority of the runtime is spent watching teenagers doing mundane, everyday things. The killer in this kind of film is usually only seen stalking and killing. Because we've compressed all that space down where it would usually be filled with teenagers swimming and playing jokes on each other and having sex, that's all been removed. And instead, what we get is something we never see in this kind of film, is the killer sat around eating ice cream and blowing his nose, doing the same mundane activities that we might expect a killer to do, but we just don't see because conventionally the filmic structure leaves no space for it. In effect, like in I Didn't Come Here to Die, we have the evil entity removed and the teenagers come to fill that void. Here, all the teenage mundane activity is removed and the killer comes to fill that void instead and leaves us with new perspectives on what the conventional situation might look like. The second thing I want to point out is the odd role reversal we get in this sequence. Typically speaking, when we get in this kind of film, when we get point of view shots, the visual coding suggests the killer is looking at a potential victim and the victim doesn't know they're being looked at. That's there to generate tension by leveraging the fact that the victim doesn't know that they're likely a target because they're just going about their lives, but we do. Here we get the opposite. We get a point of view shot from the lead protagonist's perspective looking at the killer. The interesting thing is that at this stage, the killer doesn't know that Aggie's still in the house. He thinks she's escaped. That's why he's sat around looking depressed and eating ice cream. So we have the lead protagonist looking at the killer through a point of view shot, and he doesn't know she's there. So she's come to occupy visually the space that the killer would usually occupy. And that's underlined for us by the fact that she's brandishing a knife as she's looking at him. This all cashes out towards the end of the film, where eventually Stevie catches Aggie and seemingly chokes her to death, puts her in the boot of his car and goes home. And then the next morning, he goes to go to work, living his mundane life, and this happens. Conventionally, what we'd see in this kind of film is the killer attacking the protagonist, killing them all off, confronting with the lead protagonist. The lead protagonist would then defeat them, and as Scream famously put it, we might see the killer leaping back up from the dead for one final scare. Here, because of the role reversals we've had set up earlier, we get the opposite, where we still get the conventional situation where the lead protagonist defeats the killer, but it's the lead protagonist who leaps up from the dead for one final scare. And that is underlined for us by the fact that Aggie, rather than maybe we could defend most of the survivors in these films as acting in self-defense, what she does here goes way beyond the kind of violence that a court would accept as being self-defense. There's no reason for her to rip his tongue out as well and stuff it down his throat until he chokes to death. That's the kind of gory overkill we'd usually associate with the killer, not with the lead protagonist. So because it's changed the structure of that we'd usually expect, and it also still plays out the usual conventional expectations that we'd associate with this kind of filmmaking, we are left with a situation where the role reversals are highlighted for us and new surprising expectations are generated for us that might lead us to question some of these stock roles. So I've only dealt with two examples here, and these are just two different ways that subtraction can be used. Compression can be used as a form of changing and questioning subgeneric expectations or generic expectations. The final thing I wanted to point out, however, is that once we've got this methodology in mind, once we're used to seeing subtraction as a potential form of innovation, rather than just thinking of innovation as being associated with addition, is that we might start to read what's happening in studio horror in some examples more charitably than we otherwise might. I think we tend to see more overt uses of these kinds of techniques in independent horror for the reasons I outlined at the start. There's greater incentive to take risks. But when in 2018 the reboot Halloween was released, some critics and some fans were largely unkind to this film. I have no stakes in the debate because I don't really care for Halloween as a franchise anyway. But some fans and critics were quite unkind to this film because of the choice to make this a direct sequel to the 1978 film Halloween. And the unkindness tended to come from suggesting that all of the films that happened in between, all of the canon events that had happened in between, all of the complexity that had been built into the series through retroactive continuity had just been ignored. And instead, we skipped the history, moved directly from 1978 to 2018 and carried on the story as if nothing had happened. If we instead see that removal as a way of subtracting in order to create space to move forward and maybe even reflecting and questioning what complexities had been built in, the methods of building in complexities through retroactive continuity, we might consider this kind of example of filmmaking more charitably than we otherwise would. So I think I was probably much more charitable to this film than many of the Halloween fans were. All I can say is thank you very much for your attention, and look for Subtraction where you can.